The scripture reading for today comes from the book of Hebrews, and this is Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 3 and 8 through 16. And this is the reading of the Lord. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was made from things that are not visible. And now 8 through 16. By faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out not knowing where he was going. By faith he stayed for a time in the land that he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith he received power of procreation, even though he was too old, and Sarah herself was barren, because he considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one person, and this one as good as dead, descendants were born, as many as the stars of heaven and as the innumerable grains of sand by the shore, seashore. All of these died in faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For people who seek in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of the land that they had left behind, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God. Indeed, he has prepared a city for them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, to you is all the glory this day and this hour. And we bring, Lord, to you all of the things in our lives. And we lay them at your feet at this moment. And we ask you, Lord, to just allow us to put all of those things aside, open up our hearts, open up our minds, and allow, Lord, your holy word and your presence, Lord, in the power of the Holy Spirit to be here. Use only your words today and not my own. In your name, amen. So many times anymore, my wife and I, as we're starting to get older, we start to think about, as an itinerant pastor, you don't own your home. And so you have to start thinking about when you do retire, you have to get a home and you have to purchase a home. And so my wife and I are always thinking, where would be a good place to live? Where could we start to look for a home? And it doesn't take too long before we don't really come to any conclusions on where we are to live. And can't help but feeling that we have this tremendous feeling of being homesick, like we don't have anywhere that we can call home. I mean, to be quite honest with you, life as an itinerant pastor can be kind of draining in a way, I guess you could say, when you think in terms of comfort. As much as I love living and as much as I love serving in New Brighton, I do find myself thinking a lot about where I belong in the world, where my home actually is. And it's not that anyone has done anything wrong, of course, in New Brighton. It's just a simple fact of life that when you are taken away from your home, it's usually natural to feel some level of homesickness because your home is where you always feel that you belong. Am I right? But the real depressing thing about being an itinerant pastor, or maybe just being in a lot of homesickness, is that when I do go back to my hometown in Beaver County, That place seems like a foreign place as well. It's not the same place it was when I left it 15 years ago. My children are all grown up. They don't attend the local school anymore. Most of my extended family and friends that used to live there don't live there anymore either. Or most of the people that I have known most of my life, they have either moved away from that home or they have passed on. And so when I go back to my hometown, I feel like a foreigner in a foreign land, even in my hometown these days, like I don't belong there anymore. In some ways, I feel like I am perpetually homeless. And it's not just in my hometown that I feel like I don't belong. Sometimes even in this country itself, I feel like I don't belong as well. I look around and I see our country that has taken away a lot of rights for Christians, like to pray in places like schools and or expressing any kind of Christian values and on government buildings. Remember a few years ago, if you put out nativities and things like that, that was a controversial thing. I see a country we've slipped into kind of an extreme fascination with income and wealth, so much so that it has destroyed the idea of Sunday as holy and sacred, right? Blue laws that used to exist when most of us were young don't exist anymore, right? They've all gone away in our lifetime, meaning everything is open for business on Sundays. And now we don't just need to strive to keep up with the Joneses, but it's even more. It's like we got to keep up with the Kardashians, right? I don't know. Maybe it's even beyond that now. But a few years ago, it was the Kardashians or that phrase. Remember that phrase, if it was at Nike, that was like image is everything? You know, it was just the image was everything. This doesn't only require that many people are forced to give up church in order to work on Sundays to keep their jobs, but it also sends the entire message to the populace that consumerism is more important than faith. Like we are homeless even in our own country, like we are foreigners in a foreign land, and I'm sure many of you can relate to that. Sometimes I don't feel like I belong even in the society either anymore. Maybe it's just getting older, but it feels like the world is changing so fast that I'm starting to find myself say a lot of things that my grandfather and my parents used to say to me. You know, or when you go out to eat and you get your meal, and there comes that moment when the meal comes to the table and you have to pray over it, and you get this kind of feeling of anxiety that some people will look at you while you're praying and maybe have some disgust for you. So it's only natural to not want to be the object of disgust, so there's some pressure there. Or if you bring up Jesus in a conversation, people immediately disregard you as some sort of loon or something. I mean, it's true. The fact is that a great many people think Christianity is unimportant or fantasy or these days even fanatical, and that number keeps growing more and more as the years go on. And we can probably prove this through our society's decreasing church attendance across the board, not just in the United Methodist Church, but every church struggles with church attendance or turning towards other things to believe in, leaning upon ideologies and beliefs that are in so many ways not Christian or even anti-Christian in many ways, redefining language to meet ideologies, lying to gain power, finding truth in subjective opinions, inventing realities that don't exist just to feel good. Everyone is oppressed, looking for societal or social credits. Someone is in need to make someone else a scapegoat all the time. And if you don't affirm all that someone is, then you are evil in some way or oppressor in some way, etc., etc., etc. The society just isn't the same as I remember. And so I feel homeless, like a foreigner in a foreign land. And I'm sure many of you can relate. Our scripture today essentially asks us the question, where is your home? Or where do you belong? And the answer to that question is, if it's in any of the places that I just described to you, then you're most likely headed in a direction that is not building your faith, but actually weakening your faith. In our scripture, the second part of that scripture talks about Abraham and Abraham's faith. And if you remember, Abraham's true home that we learned about in the book of Genesis was originally a place called Ur. Ur was, I think, over around Iraq or Iran, present-day Iraq today. It was far east of Palestine. And God, from that place, called Abram and Sarah, this older couple who had never had children. He called them out of that land and into a new home, a promised land, a land that he could not see, a land that he didn't know anything about, but it was a promised land to him. It was promised by God to him, a land that said that it would be flowing with children and countless descendants, which was very important, a land very different from where he was living at that moment. Abram's journey to that land was very costly. If you read the story of Abraham, it was very hard. It was a very long journey. And all along the way, all along the journey that actually lasted Abraham's entire life, he was actually homeless. He was a foreigner in a foreign land. But he still does it. He still listens to God anyway, and he wanders around homeless throughout the land, living in tents in this foreign land, never owning a thing other than a small field in Hebron, which serves as a family graveyard for him. But he does it because he has faith in God's promise to him that this land is going to be a land that would just create great descendants for him and his family. But you know what's odd about that story? Is that it doesn't seem that Abraham ever possesses the land that is promised to him. He just sort of wanders around it, right? Why do you think that may be? I'll tell you why. The answer was in Hebrews. This may seem like God went back on his promise, but the reality is that the promise of the land that was promised to Abraham was not the promise of an earthly physical land, but a heavenly promised land, only found when one takes the journey of faith in their life. And Abraham, by listening to God and leaving his home, embarks on a journey of faith that lasts his entire life. And because of this faith, from his descendants, the entire people of God come. God's promise becomes fulfilled. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. So for us, faith is the assurance of what God has already done in Jesus Christ. And our hope and our conviction is that God will do in the future what God has promised to us. No matter how dark our present is, God will bring the sun of the resurrection into our lives, thus lighting up our lives for all of eternity, not just the present moment, but for eternity. So essentially, our home is not defined as a place. It's not defined by an ideology or a belief system or an association, but defined only in terms, as was Abraham's, of our faith in God's promise to us that Jesus is our Savior and in Christ we will find eternal life. So where is your home? Where do you belong is the question. Yes, we do live in this world. In these places, we have responsibilities here, things that we need to render unto Caesar, as Scripture would say. But our ultimate home is not a land, it's not a place. And when the land seems to turn against us, to no longer be welcoming or to no longer support school prayer or blue laws, protecting church time and seem to promote selfish or powerful or financial gains over faith, or to drum up fanatical ideologies and untruths that are dangerous to those truth that is in Christ Jesus, when those things are taken away by the land, do not be surprised. The New Testament is full of writings of followers of Jesus who are living under pressure from the society around them. The biblical writings do not assume a home in which an established church reigns, blessed by a leader where the government supports the things that the Christian church does. That's never in the New Testament. That's not the world of the New Testament. Count it all for joy when you encounter these trials, Paul would say. And count on trials. Actually, almost expect them in your life. Count on feeling like you are homeless in this world. Count on feeling like a foreigner in a foreign land. That's what I hear when I've listened to the words of the New Testament. This world is not your home if you follow Jesus Christ. It ought not be a cozy place. It's a place where we work as a part of God's saving intention, but it's a place that is not our permanent home. So listen again to the things that Hebrew tells us about Abraham's home. All of these died in the faith without having received the promises, but from a distance they saw and they greeted them. They confessed that they were strangers and foreigners on the earth. For people who speak in this way make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. Your home is only in seeking Christ, brothers and sisters. Faith in Christ can be your only comfort in this world. One of the times that I felt this the most, and I've probably told this story to many of you, I was in Russia. I had the opportunity when I was over there one year, I witnessed a glimpse of maybe a true home or God's true home on earth. And it was on Orthodox Christmas Eve in Russia. And Christmas Eve in Russia is just another very dark, very cold winter evening. It's not really celebrated much in that society. It's just another work day in the evening. And it's not something that is this overwhelming sort of thing that it is here during our Christmas season. On this day, we were at the end of our mission, and always on the last day of the mission, we would do some tourist sightseeing in the city of Moscow. And so we were sightseeing, and we were a Christian group, and we were unaware of the significance of the evening because it's really not talked about much. You see, Russian Orthodox Christmas is on, I think, January 7th or 8th. And it was a very cold day and evening, and we were walking down this street called Arbat Street. And Arbat Street in Moscow is like Greenwich Village or something. It's a place where there's a lot of artists and things, tons of people selling stuff, and it's just kind of a neat place to visit. And so because we were cold at that moment, we were ducking in and out of different buildings to get warm at the time. And we happened to come across a small Orthodox church that was tucked in between all of these city buildings. It was still there, and we ducked in there to get warm. You can pay a couple of kopecks to use the restroom, and you can get warm while you're in there. And when we went in, we happened to see that there was a service going on, and we realized that it was a Christmas Eve service happening. There wasn't many people in the building. There was maybe 50 or 60 people in there. And anyway, as the Orthodox church is, there are no seats. You just sort of stand around and you watch the priest do his thing as the service is going on. And so we all sort of made our way into the sanctuary area, and we were standing around watching the priest, you know, use the incense thing, and we're hearing all this liturgy in Russian, and it was just sort of a sight to see, especially for a pastor, you know, you're kind of interested in those things. But we were all there in worship on Christmas Eve in a essentially non-Christian place. We were a group of 50 from many different homes. Some were, of course, Russian, some were American, some were socialists, some were capitalists, Orthodox and Protestants. Some were rich, some were poor. None of us could communicate with each other because we didn't speak the same language. And it was actually maybe the most wonderful service that I'd ever been a part of. I really believe that. At the end of the service, the priest took the candle and he lit it from the Christ candle, and then he passed it to everyone there, and we all had a candle. And one by one, the light of Christ was passed through the sanctuary from worshiper to worshiper, in effect, passed from nation to nation, denomination to denomination. Different people, foreigners from all different lands. And together we sang Silent Night. And my recollection, I swear with all that I am, my recollection of that moment is that we sang that song in English. And I know that we didn't. I know that we sang it in Russian, but somehow in my memory, we were singing that song in English. And one by one, the light passed through our hands. And it was really uniting us to a vision of something greater than what we live in now, igniting us to a vision of a promised land, reminding us of a home that is found not in a physical place, not in an ideology, not in an association, but found in a Savior. And we sang together, Christ the Savior is born. Us foreigners in foreign lands, on a cold night in a country that doesn't recognize a Savior, we were all home. You know, we were one family where we all belonged together. Glory be to the Lord our God, Jesus the Christ.